Sir Mike Penning.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker, and it's an honour, a true honour and privilege to follow such an important debate. Across the House, we have been united this afternoon, and I'm hoping in the adjournment debate that is now going to follow for some considerable longer, perhaps, than what some may have expected an adjournment debate to take. And it will give me the opportunity, Madam Deputy Speaker, to show that this House can come together, and houses, both houses, come together, and from those outside this House, on something which is close to your heart, Madam Deputy Speaker, I know, and certainly very close to mine. Madam Deputy Speaker, I know you as Minister of State at the Department of Health. I had the honour and privilege of, before I came to this House, of being a firefighter, and I was the Police Minister, and I was the Minister responsible for the Coast Guard, and as you seem to remember, lots of other things. That on the purpose of this debate, I think those sorts of things are really very, very important. Madam Deputy Speaker, a cenotaph for those emergency workers that we have lost. Some 7,500 emergency workers have lost their lives over the years. And the sad fact, Madam Deputy Speaker, is we will lose more. But a sad fact is there is no memorial, national memorial, for those that have gave so much to us on our behalf over the years. And I think it was so moving that we were talking about the sad loss of Jo and what happened to her. But the emergency workers that I'm talking about now in this adjournment debate were the emergency workers that went to Jo, the police and the paramedics that went there. Sadly, they didn't manage to save life, but I'm sure we all agree they would have done everything they possibly have could to save Jo like they would anybody else. And it's those that go in that direction, Madam Deputy Speaker, when very often, quite rightly, we're going in the opposite direction and some of them don't come back. And that's a commitment to humanity that we are in this debate, and what I'm calling for on the government to do is to actually acknowledge that. As I said before, the emergency services today are as dedicated to us now as they've ever been, and I'll touch on the different sides of that. But it's not just those that work for us. Believe it or not, there's 2,500 first responders out there today, mostly volunteers. The volunteers that came, for instance, during the pandemic, to help in ways that we've never probably tried to do since the Second World War, Madam Deputy Speaker. And what we need is a cenotaph here in central London. And we formed a committee, and which I had the honour of being asked if I would co-chair with the right of one of the ladies who's on the bench opposite. And I couldn't think of something as a former minister and a former fighter that I'd like to do more. But one of the things that I was quite determined about is that we did this together, as a parliament, as a country, that we try and do this. And there are different memorials around the country, and certain colleagues have come to me and said, quite rightly, their local community have come together and they have memorials for emergency workers in their constituency. But I can't believe in 2021, we do not have something here in London. Now, this is not taken away in any shape or form from the military memorials that are in, the cenotaph itself that we celebrate every year on Remembrance Day, where we remember those that have given so much and continue to serve today on our behalf around the world. It's not to take that away, but it's actually to say, could we actually say that this memorial is going to be here forever for those that have served and we've lost, for those that have volunteered and we've lost, and those going forward, sadly, Madam Deputy Speaker, long after we're all gone. So I looked very carefully at how this could be done, and the committee has looked at where it should be. And the committee would like it, and it seems to be hugely popular agreement, even from the Mayor of London and many others, to say it should be in Whitehall. And that was a unanimous decision that was done by that. And actually, as I'll come on to in a moment, Madam Deputy Speaker, most of the great and the good in this country have said so, included the Duke of Cambridge. The future king of this country has supported what we're trying to do. The cenotaph will cost a lot of money. Cenotaphs do. I don't think we're fixated exactly where in Whitehall is, and we've made a facsimile of where we would like it to be, and we've created photographs, so it could be quite close to Parliament Square. But actually, I don't think we really mind. I think the Honourable Lady and I would agree on this. We don't mind where we just want it in Whitehall, the place where the country comes together to say thank you as we go forward. Naturally, I will give way.
Honourable Member, give way. I thank my colleague for giving way, and it's an honour to be able to co-chair the committee that is campaigning for this memorial with him. And would he recognise that? I think after the 18 months that we've had, this has really taught us that we should never take for granted those that we depend on in so many different ways, that our emergency service workers are at the heart of that. All of us depend on them every single day. And that is why it would be right to have that tribute to them and to the work that they do at the very heart of where decisions are being made, and that Parliament and the government and the country should come together to support that.
Yeah. Right on, the lady has hit the nail completely on that. What better opportunity do we have? And by the way, this campaign was long before COVID. It started long before COVID. And I'll come on to a little bit about how a lovely man called Tom actually has got this thing going and we got to this stage. But actually, COVID has brought the country together in a way that we've never seen, as I say, since the Second World War. And I think even though there is an expense and there is red tape, can we cut through some of the red tape? I'll come in a moment, I'll give away on jump in a second. And people will balk at the fact that this is probably going to cost just over £3 million to do. But who cares? In the scheme of things, £3 million is such a small amount of money when it could give so much to the country. I'll give away.
Can I thank the Right Honourable Gentleman for bringing this forward? Like, I thank also the Honourable Lady as well for their perseverance for this task. Just want to say that I believe and support this campaign, because I think the Honourable Gentleman is right in what he said. This will be for the whole of the nations, for the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, for Scotland, for Northern Ireland, for Wales together, to thank all of the people for all that they have done. So I would just want the Honourable Gentleman to know that I fully support what he's about, and I do endorse his comments and his campaign.
The Honourable Gentleman is a great unionist. I believe in the union in this country, and the centre of the union in this country is where we are today. It's Westminster, it's Whitehall, and to me that's so important. And we have already raised £180,000 towards that, which has come from public donations. Well, as I go on a little bit, and unusually for me, Madam Deputy Speaker, as you know, I never read anything. I'm dyslexic, something I'm very proud of, something I can do about it, so I don't usually read. But there are certain things I want to read today so I don't get certain people's titles wrong, which I invariably do, and I don't miss anybody out. But £180,000 has been raised already. We need just over £3 million, but we need two things. And I'll come right back to this at the end of this as well. We need a decision on where it's going to be, and we need a commitment from the government to help us fund that. The 999 Cenotaph will be the first national monument to the NHS and other emergency workers that have served and will serve in the future, not just those that have fallen. I think this is quite crucial. It's not just those that have lost their lives or been seriously injured or been attacked in their line of duty. It's actually a thank you. It's somewhere where loved ones can go and just think about what their loved one has committed to the country. Some will have lost loved ones. Some will have been injured in the line of duty. But for a country not to have a central memorial to this, I think, shames us a little bit, Madam Deputy Speaker. The 999 Cenotaph is supported by His Royal Highness the Duke of Cambridge, the Prime Minister, the First Ministers of Northern Ireland, Scotland and Wales, all of the emergency services, including the fire police, Coast Guard, the RNLI, and I've not got them on the list, but we have to be conscious that there are other emergency workers that are volunteers that are not part of RNLI as well, and I learned that to my very quickly when I became the shipping minister, Madam Deputy Speaker, not to forget them, because actually, very much so, the safety inshore is very much done by them. The sculptor is Philip Jackson, the renowned Philip Jackson, who worked on the Bomber Command, or created the Bomber Command Memorial in Green Park, and closer to us here at the moment, the Gandhi statue in Parliament Square. So we couldn't have a greater person to be working on this. As I said, our preferred site is in Whitehall. And if we can get some movement on this, and I have no idea what the Minister's going to say. We have not conferred. I did write to the Prime Minister the other day, which I did supply a letter, joint letter with my co-chair. So there's no doubt what we're asking for. So hopefully I might have a bit of good news. The monument should be finished by December 22 in the year of Her Majesty's Platinum Jubilee. If we can do that, what a fantastic message that will send. There will be six figures on the plinth, plus one other, which I'll come back to in a second. It will be on Portland stone, and it will be 21 foot high from ground to the top of the memorial. It will send an enormous message about how much this country cares. There are six figures will be on the monument, plus one, and I'll come back to that in a second. The six figures will be a police officer, a firefighter, a maritime volunteer, a nurse, a paramedic, and a member of the search and rescue volunteer team, plus a service dog. We mustn't forget that it's not just human beings that go out there, and very often they go out there with the service dogs, whether that be police, mountain rescue, or in other ways. The figure of dog will be a spaniel. I think there was a little bit of discussion about what type of dog. We're all great dog lovers in this country, but I think the spaniel probably works the best way. And those of us who are in this chamber on a regular basis before the house opens for business, the spaniels are here protecting us, and I can't think of a better breed of dog to be there. How do we get to this stage? So a gentleman, I've referred to him earlier on, but informally as Tom, Tom Scholes Fogg, in 2016, is now the trustee since 2016. In 2001, his grandfather, John, was a police sergeant in Greater Manchester, and months away from retirement, one of his officers, PC Alison Armitage, was tragically killed on duty. And I think that sparked something in him. And can I say at this stage that in my own constituency, we have PC Frank Mason shot by bank robbers outside of Barclays Bank years ago. And every single year we come back and we pay tribute to him. That's a small memorial in a constituency, in the middle of a town centre. I want one out here for the likes of Frank as well. What Tom discovered, it surprised him, was there was no national memorial. And when I first looked at this, I thought, of course we do. But actually, we don't. So I think from one tragedy that happened to Alison, through Tom's grandfather, John, now through Tom's commitment with his trustees and with his commitment, and we've done all the directors and we've done all the red tape and the Charity Commission are very happy, we've got to this stage. And we have some interesting quotes, Madam Deputy Speaker. As a society, we owe our well-being and indeed our lives to the men and women of our emergency service who work tirelessly to protect us in some of the most difficult circumstances. And it is only fitting that we should recognise the vital role that they play and pay tribute to their bravery, dedication of those who made the ultimate sacrifice for our communities. That was said by the Right Honourable Prince William, the Duke of Cambridge. It takes a very special kind of person to put their life on the line for a complete stranger. There's a long quote here from the Prime Minister. He's fully committed to it in his quotes here. I know of dedicated men and women in emergency services who get into a line of work for, they don't go into this for applause or and praise, they go because they want to do it. You are the heroes of British life, and I fully support what we're calling for, which is the... And I could go on, Madam Deputy Speaker, from the First Minister at the time in Northern Ireland, and actually the leader of the DUP in Northern Ireland is one of our parliamentarians that supports this, Nicola Sturgeon, Mark Drakeford, and on and on. So, basically, I'm saying to the Minister, we have commitment from all the powers in this country, can't be much greater than the future king of this country, the prime minister of this country, the leaders of all parts of this country. We have, I can assure the minister, we have fantastic support from both sides of the house. In the scheme of things, it's a small amount of money. The worst thing we would like, but the best thing from one side, is of course if we were exempt from VAT for this project. The next thing might be, perhaps, that the Treasury would match fund us. I don't know what the Minister's going to say, but actually what I'd like is to show the commitment to our emergency workers and our service animals and the government to say we're going to help you find a spot with the Westminster City Council in Whitehall, and by the way, we're going to pay for it. And I can't think of a better way to spend the British pound than to do that. Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker.
Minister Caroline Dynage.
Oh, thank you very much, Madam Deputy Speaker. I'd like to start by congratulating my honourable friend, the Member for Hemel Hempstead, on securing this really important adjournment debate and for highlighting what is an incredibly important cause. Today, almost 2 million people, 3% of the population, work and volunteer in the emergency services and the NHS, including 250,000 first responders. And as the Right Honourable Lady from Normanton Pontefract and Castleford said, we've really seen through the pandemic just how acutely we rely upon them, how our NHS and 999 heroes have continued working and volunteering to save lives. And I have to start really by paying tribute to my honourable friend. When I was a very, very new Member of Parliament, he came down to visit me and my constituency when he was a very important, I think, probably transport minister.
Shipping minister.
And he has always been a huge supporter of those of us who have constituencies on the coast and who rely upon those the emergency services, many of which are manned and staffed by some incredibly heroic volunteers in my own constituency. It's the gaffers who man the rescue services that go out into the Solent on a really frequent basis to save lives, and they are absolute heroes, every single one of them. And I know that he worked really hard with me and my constituency and the Maritime Coast Guard Agency, who are based there to promote their important work. So, you know, he has a great track record of promoting our emergency services, and I know that those working in our NHS and in our 999 services day in and day out are absolutely our unsung heroes. They're always there to help us in the moments of greatest need, when we're at our worst, at our weakest, and we honour them, and we must never ever forget the sacrifices they make for us. And I would therefore like to echo everything that's been said today by my honourable friend and others in praising the heroic actions of all emergency service personnel. And I know that the campaign for an appropriate monument to honour those who served and continue to serve in the emergency services, I know it began back in 2017, but actually, if ever there was a time to reflect upon what they have achieved and the dedication and the service of our 999 heroes, it really is in the wake of this COVID crisis.
I thank the Minister for giving way, and thank goodness we've got plenty of time to debate this evening. That was really nice, and thank you for giving way. I'm sure you're aware this is 999 Day. Something I think Armed Forces Day is fantastic, but we need to get that message out around the country that this is 999 Day, and actually this is when we should be out there in our constituencies and around the country praising our emergency workers.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. Yeah, I think my honourable friend's absolutely right to raise that. It is a day when we should all be celebrating, thanking those who do this sterling, important and life-saving work. So I very much support his calls for an appropriate 999 memorial. if I'm honest, Madam Deputy Speaker, his letter to the Prime Minister was only written very recently, I think, on the 30th of August. I've only just had a chance to look at it and start considering the proposals and the suggestions that it makes. But I would be very, very happy to meet him and his committee to discuss some of the asks in it in more detail and see what we can do to work with them on this. I think it is really important to celebrate positive parts of our culture and our cultural and our civic life, and new memorials such as this will help us to understand events. They do help us to understand events. They help us to acknowledge achievements and mark sacrifices. They commemorate what's important about our present and our past, and that future generations can learn from. And the government is committed to supporting the emergency services and is steadfast in honouring the sacrifices that have been made. I know the Prime Minister and the Home Secretary recently attended the dedication of the UK Police Memorial at the National Arboretum, and this memorial and others serve as a valuable symbol, acting as a reminder to the public of the sacrifices that have been made, and providing also a space for people to mourn and remember lost loved ones. But I know that this particular memorial monument that my honourable friend is calling for is actually about not just those who have lost their lives in their service, but those who continue to serve, and that's why this is unique and important. And I think it's important to say it's not just at a national level that we erect statues to remember the contribution of others, but they do take pride of place in local communities up and down the country. You know, and we commemorate our own local heroes, and many of these figures are a real source of local pride. And I think being commemorated in a public space, often funded by public subscription, is a really positive way to acknowledge the contributions that individuals have made both to their communities and to the nation. So at this point, I think it is only fair, Madam Deputy Speaker, that I should explain that it is not normal practice for central government to fund new memorials. Many organisations... Yes, I will.
Point, and I thank her for the offer of meeting, and it's always a pleasure. We've shared a department together when we were ministers together as well. And I hope we get a reply from the Prime Minister, who did have the letter simultaneously when the Minister had it. I'm not going to hold the Minister to this, but conversations perhaps need to take place with the Treasury before our meeting, because I can't think of a better use of LIBOR money or unclaimed assets in bank accounts than this. And there are millions of pounds sitting in LIBOR. Now we know that, and it's been used extensively in other ways, Madam Deputy Speaker. But this would be a great way of not putting a burden so much on the taxpayer. Not, I don't think the taxpayer would be too worried about that at the end of the day, because it is a tiny amount of money. However, the LIBOR funds is probably the way forward, and perhaps the Treasury could have a conversation with the first.
Yes, thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. I think that is certainly a conversation that needs to be had with the Treasury. I mean, it's true that many organisations, both public and private, are very rightly able to propose and to fund and to develop and deliver memorials marking a variety of incidents and historical moments. They are. Unfortunately, not normally funded by the government, but you know, he makes some interesting suggestions as to how that might be addressed, and we can certainly talk about it further. I think that these organisations and individuals are usually best placed to determine who to commemorate and how best to build commemorations that are both appropriate and sensitive. But there are. You know, and there are a great many people and organisations who are interested in establishing memorials. So as a general rule, it is for those groups to work with the relevant local planning authorities and other organisations to identify suitable sites and obtain the necessary planning permission and to raise the funding. And in fact, actually, during the passing of the Deregulation Act of 2015, consent from the Secretary of State for Digital Culture, Media and Sport isn't actually any longer required to erect memorials and statues in London. It's not now just determined through the planning system only. So in relation to the proposed site on Whitehall, this would be a matter for Westminster City Council. But that's something that we can discuss when we chat. But there is a very long tradition of funding new memorials through public subscription, which the government supports, and experience has shown that there are often other funders, including in the private sector, who are very happy and very willing to contribute and donate to fund new memorials. In fact, I think a lot of the British public take huge pride in feeling that they have played a part in delivering something which is so important and so significant for our national life. But of course, there are examples of government supporting memorials to mark specific events. There have been memorials created to the victims of 9/11, of the 7/7 bombings in London, as well as those of the Bali bombings in 2002. The government also supported the suffragist memorial on Parliament Square and the one created by an independent Iraq-Afghanistan Memorial Project charity to honour those who served in the Iraq-Afghan wars. So in some circumstances, government does support new memorials, although it's not for the government to determine which memorials go ahead, and certainly with limited public funds, it's not possible for central government to fund them. That said, the government does offer some indirect financial support through the Memorial Grants Scheme, and this scheme allows charities and faith groups to claim as a grant the equivalent of the VAT paid on the eligible cost of erecting, maintaining or repairing public memorials, and this scheme is administered by my department, the DCMS, for the whole of the UK. So, in a nutshell, Madam Deputy Speaker, we entirely recognise the extraordinary efforts of our emergency service in serving the public, not just during the pandemic, but actually, you know, at all times. Faced with unbelievable challenges, these incredible people do look after people up and down our country and often save lives in the most difficult of circumstances. And we definitely support all the efforts and conversations that are ongoing at the moment to find an appropriate way to mark their incredible dedication and sacrifice.
The question is that this House do now adjourn. As many